and by night strangle them with silken handkerchiefs in the name of their goddess, Kali. She was not only the goddess of stranglers, let's say. And it's also the subject of a Gunga Din is all about the tug. But this was the true story of the Englishman who busted them. And apparently he busted them by disguising himself as one of them and went nuts.
Yeah.
Because he discovered he was good at his work.
How long were you over there in India?
4 months. 4 months, yeah. 1987.
Because being on location is no vacation.
I had the best time of my life making that movie. Making movies on location, I think, is a lot of fun. India was, to me, an explosion of a different reality. I made friends there that I have forever. It was everything. It was wonderful. It was appalling. It was, you know, and you went through all the stages of being the ugly American and why doesn't the phone work and this and this and this. But at the end of the day, I'm so glad that I made that movie. I'm so glad I was there.
And then you were in London for a while.
Well, because we prepared the movie in London and finished the movie in London, we were basically, I was away from Hollywood for a year. And at the end of that year, I said to my wife, I don't want to go home. I want to stay here. And I don't know if I can earn a living here, but I'd like to try. So we decided to have a reality check. So in July of 88, still paying rent on this house in Chelsea, we came back to Los Angeles, and we stayed until George Bush the first was elected president of the United States. And I said, I'm out of here.
Listen, I would love, Nicholas, if you would read a little bit from your book and let people hear sort of, because in some ways you've written a novel about a character named Nicholas Meyer.
Well, this is a passage about my experience making a movie called The Day After, which is a movie about nuclear war. And making this movie was fraught with controversy and contention. And I got into an argument with ABC over the cut of the movie. And a lot of times in this business, confronted by your own impotence in the face of corporate and contractual reality, you think you will die. That all these corporate honchos had wept buckets when they first saw the cut of the movie only compounded my misery, which is to say my cut. That I had labored so hard and given so much of myself, not to mention the people who worked on the film both in Hollywood and by the thousands in Lawrence, Kansas, who had all trusted me, to something I thought so terribly important, and then to see it ripped to meaningless shreds was enough to make me contemplate suicide, really. It was the first of many such contemplations. I crawled into bed and stayed there for days while my long-suffering agent, Gary Lucchese, labored behind the scenes on my behalf to effect some kind of rapprochement. Agents must take the long view. They don't want their clients blackballed from future projects because they made waves, a reputation with which I was already flirting. The only good news about being so desperately hurt and angry was that I couldn't eat, which in my case did have some benefits. I simply couldn't get my head around the fact of my powerlessness against a large corporation, even though I had brought the film into being, given it life, made them weep when they saw it, then fended off all their absurd compromises, but I finally couldn't fend off them. The film was theirs. It was their idea. They commissioned it. They paid for it. I was merely the hired hand. Any droit moral was theirs. Why was I unable to accept this reality? Grow up.
Terrible. I mean, there are times, and then you come home and you say, I'm never going to work again till the next phone call.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, I'm like Eliza on the ice.
Yeah.
And when we live in a melting world, as I said at one point in the book, I'm working in a hardening artery that I hope is not my own.
Yeah. The other part, too, is not just there the day after, but there was another film where at the end, the producer or whoever you were working with took exception to the fact that you had changed. You thought he was just, you know, looking at the film. He said, that's my cut, and you're making a terrible thing to come in and overcut me.
This was Leonard Nimoy, who was the executive producer of Star Trek VI, looked at the movie and said, you know, can I fiddle with the last reel? And I said, sure. He was the executive producer and a knowledgeable guy. So yes, you know, and I looked at his cut and I thought, oh, this is good. I wonder what would happen if I did this and this. And then when I showed it to him, he went berserk and he said, well, why did you fiddle with my, what, you know, how dare you touch mine? I thought, how dare I? How dare I? I'm the director.
He gets first cut. In some cases, in a contract, nobody can fiddle with the director's first cut.
There are directors, by the way, who also have final cut, fewer and fewer. I am not one of those.
There is a poignant moment, too, at the end of Star Trek VI that is the end. It is the end.
The end of the for the first cast, yeah.
Yeah.
It was very bizarre. No one quite, you know, and interestingly enough, films are not always scheduled to be shot in sequence. Yeah. But in the case of this film, they, I think for compelling psychological reasons, scheduled the last scene to be shot on the last day of the shoot. So it really, it was a dual ending. It was the ending of the movie and it was the ending of the work for this cast. So
Nicholas,
it was very strange.
Nicholas, what's the film you really want to make now?
Oh, there's lots. I you know, I have The Rise of Theodore Roosevelt. I've done a movie about George Washington, my hero. I wrote a movie that I quite like for HBO called Patient Number One. Very interesting story.
Has it been made? No.
Nope, none of them have been made. Don Quixote, which I'm obsessed with. Hollywood's never done Don Quixote.
Why are you obsessed with him?